We're on.
Okay. Get these words up here. Where did they go? There they are. So hi, everybody, and welcome once again to PMBiP, the Popular Music Books in Process series, a joint project of IOSPM US, the Journal of Popular Music Studies, and the Pop Conference. I'm Carl Wilson, one of the series organizers, along with Eric Weisbart and Kimberly Mack. You can find our whole calendar on the IOSPM website, and you can catch up on our videos of all our past sessions, including last week's great talk about Bushwick Bill from Charles Hughes with Regina Bradley on Eric's channel on YouTube. I have a couple of quick announcements to make before we get started. First, the breaking news that after we wrap up in mid-July, we're going to take a break, but we have decided to bring the PMBiP series back for the fall book season. We're going to put out a call for proposals around the beginning of July. But also to help with all of that, we're considering bringing on an extra person to help with organizing duties. So if you've been a regular attendee and doing some behind the scenes administration as well as, helping in the sessions themselves appeals to you, please get in touch and let us know. You can just reply all to the mailing list email. So that's that news. Today, also, we're doing the first of 2 weeks of digital presentations, still followed by discussion and Q&A. That's also a chance to remind you that the Journal of Popular Music Studies is actively seeking digital presentations for a 2021 roundup. So please email Eric if you want to offer one of your own or suggest one you saw that you particularly liked. Next week, our digital presenters will be Norma Coates on rock and roll on American television from the 50s to the 70s, and Sarah Gulkis on the politics of memory involved when 60s rock went baroque. But today, we've got Lucretia Tye Jasmine with a lecture based on her book in progress, The Golden Era of Groupies, 1965 to 1978, as well as Jeffrey Melnick introducing his early stage book project, The Modern Sounds of Boston, Massachusetts, on the cultural geographies and racial dynamics of Boston's music scenes from about 1974 to 1999. So, quick biographies. Lucretia Tye Jasmine is originally from Kentucky, but now a Los Angeles-based artist, writer, and interviewer, whose most recent work includes the Groupie Feminism art series, online writing for Please Kill Me and the Los Angeles Beat, and interviews for Feminist Magazine Radio and the GRAMMY Museum. Her zines, films, and art have been featured in Alien She, the New York Times, and the Punk Museum Los Angeles, and housed at Duke, the Getty Center, NYU, and the Library of Congress. Lucretia has conducted extensive oral histories for her two mixtape zines, the Groupie Gospels and Riot Girl Los Angeles, 1992 to 1995. And Jeff Melnick has been studying, teaching about, and publishing on various issues in popular music since the mid-1990s, including a stint as editor-in-chief of Journal of Popular Music Studies. With Rachel Rubin, he's co-edited a book series on American popular music for the University of Massachusetts Press and published widely from his first book, A Right to Sing the Blues, African Americans, Jews, and American Popular Song, to his most recent Creepy Calling with the Manson Family. These days, a good proportion of Jeff's work life is taken up with matters connected to his position as communications director for his union. So as always during their conversation, and especially maybe even more so during a digital lecture, please put your questions as they come to you in the chat sidebar. In the last part of the session, Kim will use them to call on you for the Q&A. And of course, you can also use the chat for comments and for chat. So now let's get the presentations underway.
Okay, hi, can you all hear me okay? Awesome, okay. So I wrote down just the brief intro. Hi, thank you for being here. This means a lot to me. My 19-minute presentation includes an introduction over a title page and a picture of a vinyl 45 in its sleeve, followed by a brief summary of the 10 chapters I'm working on now. But I think I'm gonna have like 6 more chapters. Then, a romp through some art as I provide the afterword, a bibliography, and a list of slides. Shall I begin? Okay, so the other thing is I've never done this before. So bear with me while I do this, and I hope it works. Hold on just a sec. I have to somehow be able to see this. Hold on just a second, everybody. I can't seem to get the little the search space thing that I normally can find. Hold on. Oh, everyone, please, I'm sorry. I did it okay when we practiced a minute ago, but now this little thing up here, hold on. I'm gonna do this. Hold on just a second. Now I can, oh my gosh. Oh my God. My hand is shaking so bad. Hold on, everybody. It's like out of control.
You got this, Lucretia. We saw you do it 10 minutes ago.
I know, I just did it. I know I can do it. All right, screen share. Share computer sound. All right. Who is she? There she is, front row, or on the side of the stage, or backstage. She's sometimes in the photographs, on the album covers, in liner notes, in music magazines and biographies. Who is she? The Golden Era of Groupies, 1965 to 1978, is a nonfiction book about some of those girls and women. I begin my groupieology in 1965, when the term groupie was coined, and I end it in 1978 with the mysterious death of a punk rock groupie. My book includes archival images, images of art from my Groupie Feminism art series, and songs by or about the women from the Golden Era of Groupies. Groupies emerged in the 60s, in the 1960s, on the cusp of second wave feminism, as the avant-garde of the sexual revolution, navigating old-fashioned double standards with daring independence. Fans with the band, groupies went further than just going to the show. They lived their lives as though they could equal rock stars in creative and sexual freedom. But corporate interests and the double standard impeded women's liberation, and groupies were often dismissed as playthings in the power ballad of music history. Groupies mirror feminism's struggle and insistence. The term itself, groupie, signifies cultural difficulty with the emancipation of girls and women. As with so many terms that refer to girls and women, the word began as a way to identify, but turned into a sexual slur. The word groupie is emblematic of the feminist impulse and also the cultural difficulty with accepting girls and women as equals to boys and men. The Golden Era of Groupies, 1965 to 1978, tells the stories of some of these extraordinary women. Here are several from my book about them. Chapter 1, Foxy Lady, Lithophane Priggin. Who is the Foxy Lady in Jimi Hendrix's 1967 song? Many believe it's Lithophane Priggin, pictured here with Hendrix on the cover of a magazine. Born in Georgia, 1940, Priggin frequented clubs as a teen and was nicknamed Apollo Fane because she was so often backstage at Harlem's Apollo Theater, a super groupie as the term was being coined. Friends and lovers with James Brown, Sam Cooke, Jimi Hendrix, Little Willie John, and Sly Stone, she recorded an unreleased album of songs that she wrote. Priggin wrote a song for Sly Stone to produce, and she wrote the liner notes for an Etta James album. Chapter 2, Lick Me, Cherry Vanilla. Cherry Vanilla, the career girl from Queens, New York, writes in her memoir about Lady Clawhane, who was her best friend during childhood. A shy Dalmatian dog who died from heartache and a forced abortion by Cherry's father and brother. Cherry told me, a lot of kids, their dream is to leave their small town and get to the big city. I was only across the bridge from the big city. I didn't have to leave the small town, but I had to leave my small life. I knew I had to get across that bridge.
She did just that in 1961 at the age of 18 for a life that spanned both coast and international travels. A Warhol superstar who worked as David Bowie's PR rep, she formed her own band, bringing street cred to bandmates who went on to chart-topping fame as the Police. This is Cherry with Sting in the background in a 1977 photo by Ray Stevenson. Chapter 3, Groupie Feminism, GTOs, or Girls Together Outrageously. GTOs were seven young adult women from the West Coast whose circus-like performances and freaky clothes extended from the audience onto the stage for experimental music that included spoken word and famous rock stars. Known as a groupie group because their antics offstage commanded as much attention as the band onstage, here are the GTOs, lower left to upper middle to lower right, and a photograph from the late 60s. Miss Pamela, lower left. Miss Sandra. Miss Mercy. Miss Cinderella. Miss Sparky, upper middle. Miss Lucy. And Miss Christine, lower right. Led Zeppelin's Robert Plant once said the GTOs gave a good a-looning as they got. The GTOs cut an album, performed at concerts, influenced Alice Cooper and Kiss, and fell apart because of drugs and betrayals. Pamela DeBoer wrote 1987's best-selling I'm With the Band, Confessions of a Groupie, about her time as a groupie and as a GTO. This is the album, GTO's Permanent Damage from 1969. Chapter 4, Rock Hard, Cynthia Plastercaster. Cynthia Plastercaster, the art student from Chicago who founded the Plastercasters of Chicago, famously plaster casted the genitalia of musicians. Frank Zappa brought her to LA, promising a museum in her honor. Instead, his manager allegedly stole Cynthia's casts. Thank goodness she's got bronze copies. Shy and with a zany sense of humor, Cynthia says her casts look like a chorus line. She ran for mayor under the Hard Party banner in 2010. She's pictured here with her casting mate, Diane, in a photograph from 1968 by Baron Woman. Chapter 5, Groupies on Vinyl, the Groupie Album. The women with East Coast accents who talk about being groupies with all its delights and debasements are featured on an album called The Groupies from Earth Records, 1969. Their motivations to live a fun-loving life with freedoms similar to men's are tempered by what they experience and witness as groupies. Their names aren't listed anywhere on the album or in the liner notes. But further research tells me they are probably Cleo Odzer and Cookie Davidson. Chapter 6, Steppin' in Her I. Miller Shoes, Devin Wilson. A Libra born in Wisconsin in 1943, Ida Mae Wilson renamed herself Devin, ran away from home to Las Vegas, Nevada, and there met Quincy Jones, who helped her move to California. Wilson was involved with Arthur Lee, Miles and Betty Davis, Jimi Hendrix, and Mick Jagger. Known for her charisma and her ability to procure drugs, women, and housing for a few very famous musicians, Wilson was on Jimi Hendrix's payroll. He wrote a song about the time she sucked the blood from Mick Jagger's cut so he wouldn't need a Band-Aid. The song is 1971's Dolly Dagger. After her mysterious and fatal fall in 1971 from a balcony at Chelsea Hotel, Betty Davis wrote a song about her too, and it's the title of this chapter. She's pictured here, Devin Wilson, in a photograph by Baron Woman for Rags Magazine in an article about her from 1970. Chapter 7, Baby Groupies, LA Queens. On the West Coast in the early 1970s, underage girls flocked to the Sunset Strip, looking for fun and freedom in the skin-loving sunshine and exciting nightlife of a musically happening Los Angeles. Led Zeppelin wrote a song about those baby groupies, calling them the LA Queens. One of the LA Queens, Lori Lightning, was abducted from a club by Jimmy Page in a Zeus-like enchantment, while LA Queens Sable Star and Tyla kicked each other in competition for rock stars' attention on the dance floor. Morgana Welch sat center court with the band and the groupies in this photograph by Richard Creamer. Star Magazine featured some of those baby groupies too, including Lori, Sable, Shrey Meacham, and Queenie Glam. Star Magazine was known as a groupie magazine. Chapter 8, Power Ballad, Sweet Connie. Sweet Connie, the groupie who claims to have slept with over 1,000 musicians, including politician Bill Clinton, extended her favors to all road personnel, not just the band, because she believes everyone deserves to have a good time. She's name-dropped in Grand Funk Railroad's anthemic song from 1973, We're an American Band. An exuberant partier born in 1955 from Arkansas, where she's lived her entire life and worked as a school teacher, Sweet Connie wears good girl manners like the gold glitter on her body, welcoming and sparkly. She gleefully shared her experiences on talk shows and in magazines such as Penthouse, Cosmopolitan, pictured here, and Spin, matter-of-factly describing her adventures even as others mocked her, harassed her at home, prank-called her, and she even handled the strident radio host Howard Stern with calm elan. Chapter 9, Vintage, Barbara the Butter Queen. By the time Barbara the Butter Queen was 22 in 1972, she visited 52 major cities in the US and 11 different countries by touring with bands. The Texan with a Southern drawl as compelling as her use of butter, a finesse that impressed musicians as far-ranging as pop star David Cassidy, the wild rollickers of the Mad Dogs and Englishmen, and raunchy rockers, the Rolling Stones, who wrote a song about her. The Butter Queen was a mama's girl who collected vintage clothes and reportedly kept diaries of her on-the-road experiences. In 2018, she died in a fire at the lifelong home she shared with her mom in Texas, the Butter Queen's vintage glamour and diaries aflame. At first, she eschewed the term groupie because she said she was a lady. Then Barbara the Butter Queen proclaimed the term proudly on talk shows and on her Wikipedia page. Chapter 10, Pretty Dope Queen, Nancy Spungen. Precocious Nancy Spungen from Pennsylvania quit college in Colorado to live in New York City when she was 17 during the mid-70s and where she became a punk rocker. She traveled to London to be with a heartbreaker and there met Sid Vicious, the bassist for punk band The Sex Pistols. Banned from the band's 1978 tour, Spungen became Vicious's manager when he went solo. She had a high IQ, supported feminism, worked as a sex worker, and she wished the ERA had passed. In 1978, she died a bloody death in the bathroom at the Chelsea Hotel where she lived with Vicious. Was she stabbed or did she stab herself? Spungen had a history of altercations, drug addiction, and mental health challenges. Police told Spungen's mother that Nancy was just another dead junkie, and a detective referred to Nancy as a druggy slut. A medical examiner called her a piece of shit. Nancy Spungen is pictured here in a photo courtesy of Oceano Ambar in a recent Vogue article that pays tribute to her. Afterward, understanding the relevance of groupies is a necessity. Paradoxical with their reflective glory and often unmarried independence, it is important to understand groupies in terms of self-government. Groupies have been insulted and dismissed, often abused for their love and potential for sex. The G word confounds. An extremely influential and famous feminist refused to share the stage of a talk show with a GTO. A rock star said she wasn't sure if she should allow Pamela DeBar to interview her. Cherry Vanilla's groupie poem, is a lament. The women I've discussed have sometimes struggled with the term groupie. An established writer vehemently disagreed with me that Priggen was a groupie. He even disagreed that she was a super groupie. But as music scholar Lisa Royds points out, without groupies, there'd be no rock star. Owning property, earning a living, earning a wage equal to men for equal work in any job, and not only in sex work, as is still the case, living alone or unmarried, obtaining an individual bank account and an individual credit card, wearing short skirts or long pants, walking alone in public during the day or at night, having an appetite and expressing desire and experiencing sovereignty are all freedoms sought and sometimes granted during the golden era of groupies. Legislation has grappled with controlling the bodies of women. Language and laws threaten to stifle or promise to free. During the golden era of groupies, birth control was available and the right to safe and legal abortions passed in 1973. But the Equal Rights Amendment did not pass and hasn't yet. Sexual harassment wasn't legally defined until 1980. Husbands could rape wives legally until the early 1990s. Eating disorders have long distracted and disabled girls and women. Domestic violence is encouraged in a culture that thinks it has a right to the bodies of girls and women. By 1978, groupies were embraced for their sexual services to the exclusion of their other and previous creative contributions, such as Cherry Vanilla's PR, GTO's fashion and record contract sense, Cynthia Plastercaster's art, Devin Wilson's resourcefulness, and Nancy Spungen's determination. Why can't we be productive as well as reproductive? My book will also include some discussion of groupies post-1978, such as Adriana Smith and Courtney Love. In the 1980s, Smith didn't get royalties for her real-life orgasmic moans on a smashingly successful Guns N' Roses record. In the 1990s, Love became a bona fide rock star. When we perceive the multidimensionality of groupies and allow the wonderful space of understanding groupies as ardent fans who are creative equals and partners to those they love, then the word groupie will not be an insult anymore. Pictured here is art from my Groupie Feminism art series. It's called Gold Fan. It lists several songs by or about groupies. And here is my Groupie Mixtape. On my Groupie Mixtape are the songs that mention or refer to or are related to the women I've discussed in this book, The Golden Era of Groupies, 1965 to 1978. Here is also a list of those songs and links to them. And my bibliography, which is also in process, like my book, begins with a picture of some assemblage art from my Groupie Feminism art series. It's called The Rock and Roll Groupie Locker. And then for the slides that credit the slides are two assemblage art pieces from my Groupie Feminism art series. Both are original doors from the Chelsea Hotel. Love Letters in the Pocket features actual love letters from fans of rock stars and fans of groupies. A door is adorned with items that a rock star or groupie might give to a rock star or groupie. Thank you.
Okay, can you still hear me? Thanks. All right, okay. I just want to say real quick, while I was doing that presentation, Jeff, your work inspired me because we had a brief email exchange about migration and like basically travel. And I realized something I hadn't thought of before, which is that these groupies get around. They travel, they leave their homes, they book. So with that, I want to introduce you and your work. Hi, Jeff, this is Jeffrey Melnick.
That was a great presentation, and thanks for the nice handoff as well. I'm really delighted to be in conversation with Lucretia and with all the rest of you today. So I'm gonna talk for 2 or 3 minutes, and then I'm gonna start my slideshow, and we'll see how it goes and take it from there. So first of all, let me say a couple of introductory things to get my portion of the event started. The first and most important is a heartfelt thank you to Kimberly and to Eric and to Carl for organizing this fabulous forum. Really, truly, I've gotten so much out of it already as an audience member and look forward to engaging with all of you tonight about the work, which is very much in process. This is literally the first public thing I've done out of this project. So I'm really excited to be with you all. And so thanks for showing up. I hope you have good air conditioning wherever you are, if it's as brutal where you are as it is where I am. The second thing I want to say is that this is my first pre-recorded anything I've ever done. I made it through a year and 2 months of remote teaching without pre-recording anything. So you'll be kind about the production values, which are non-existent, but I did it. And I only had to call my 24-year-old daughter 3 or 4 times to talk me through it. So I think we'll see. I think it'll work. I have a couple other people to thank really quickly. There's an amazing colleague of mine on the call, who's a research librarian at UMass Boston, Jessica Holden. Literally could not do this work without Jessica's support and the amazing archives that I'm drawing from that she has helped organize and curate at UMass Boston. Holly Cruz is here. She's already been an incredible advisor to me. I know most of you know Holly's work, and she's already been kind of pushing me on my way and connecting me to some people that she knows. And a couple of friends who have talked to me about this work as I've gotten it started, and they're not allowed to say how long I've been talking to them about it, because it's supposed to be like I just started, look, it's just getting going. But Dan Itzkovitz is here, and my friend Richard Cobian's here, and my friend Dimitri Itzkovitz is here, and they're all people who have talked and walked and helped me feel encouraged about the work. The third and most predictable thing I'll say is that you all probably saw advertising for this with me working under a different title, and of course, on the airplane on my way here, I decided on a different title as I was writing the talk. And so it's no longer Real Kids and Pixies. That was kind of based on a joke or a double entendre that turned out not to be worth making. So the new title, The Modern Sounds of Boston, Massachusetts, is just basically meant to open a window via the song it invokes, obviously, Roadrunner, on a generation of musical life and youth culture here. The periodization that I'm working with for now, and this is something that I'm anxious to talk with you about and see what you think about, is 1974 to 1999. 1974, you'll hear a bunch about in my slideshow, and it's, I think, pretty obvious, and I feel pretty confident. You can try to shake me from it if you want, but I'm pretty set on 1974 as a starting point. 1999, I'm a little less set on, and I'll just say briefly why I'm provisionally using 1999 as my end date, which is I'm trying to capture this kind of generation of youth culture, race, class, the changes in cultural geography in Boston. And 1999 is when Sean Fanning invents Napster in his dorm room at Northeastern. And it puts puts an exclamation point on a lot of the things I'm talking about. In conversation with a few people already, I've started thinking like, well, maybe 1996 and the Telecommunications Act is more important than Napster to the kind of street activity, the club activity, the radio activity I'm thinking about. But that's for us to talk about after my slideshow. So I'm gonna try to get this thing going. I'll do the usual mess here of not being able to do it and then do it. So bear with me for a second. The title of my talk today is Modern Sounds of Boston, Massachusetts. And the central idea of the project is fairly simple. I trust you all will tell me if it is too simple, but it seems necessary to me. It begins with the most obvious historiographical observation. We have plenty of books about race in Boston, about the desegregation. Are you hearing this and seeing it? You're not. Okay. Hang on. Sorry.
I was hearing it, but not seeing it.
Okay. Yeah. Sorry, guys.
Planning that destroyed the traditional
All right, I'm working on it.
City from the utter destruction.
Are you seeing it now?
Not yet.
Okay, I'll get it.
You will.
Share screen. Okay, you guys seen it now?
Yes, yes.
Okay, yes. Let me make sure I got the sound shared. I'm gonna try to start it over. Okay. You're seeing it, tell me if you, you know what, I'm just gonna go into the middle. Tell me if you hear, you hear me talking?
Of the 1981 yes. Paul Newman
okay.
Movie.
Thank you, here we go.
The title of my talk today is Modern Sounds of Boston, Massachusetts. And the central idea of the project is fairly simple. I trust you all will tell me if it is too simple, but it seems necessary to me. It begins with the most obvious historiographical observation. We have plenty of books about race in Boston, about the desegregation crisis of the 1970s, about the related subject of residential segregation, about various high profile crimes and so on. And we also have plenty of journalistic and memoiristic writing about Boston music from the 1970s forward, but very little that imagines that these areas of inquiry occupy the same geographies. Any history of Boston's modern musical past that is worth its salt has to contend with Boston's complex and troubled racial history. The period and scenes I explore developed directly after a time of upsetting racial divisiveness, particularly in the context of what generally gets called Boston's busing crisis, but should be called Boston's white backlash against school integration, and by the urban planning that destroyed the traditional geography of the city. From the utter destruction of the Old West End to the medical colonization of Mission Hill, the creation of the Vice District popularly known as the Combat Zone, and gentrification of so many neighborhoods from the South End in Boston to Kendall Square in Cambridge. The dialogue between the political and economic worlds of Boston, riven by race conflict, undone and reconstructed by urban renewal and gentrification, and shaped every year by the mass migration of college students and its youth musical cultures will form the heart of this ongoing investigation. So in the time I have with you today, I can only hint at some of the questions we might begin to ask if we emphasize race and class in conversations about Boston music of the era. I'm just going to try to give three quick snapshots that are meant as conversation starters. So let me index those three snapshots for you. I'll call them Fort Apache the Rocks, Mr. Butch at the Rat, and Marky Mark on the Wild Side. I start in 1974 for a few reasons that seem compelling to me. Above all, September of that year is when Judge Arthur Garrity's desegregation order was put into effect in the public schools. That same month, UMass Boston opened up in Dorchester. It's also the year the original Modern Lovers broke up, and the year that the Rathskeller, the Rat, the most mythologized club in Boston's music history, started hosting live music. 1974 is also the year the Combat Zone was officially zoned as the Adult Entertainment District of Boston, with all kinds of intersectional tales of race, class, and gender embedded. And it's the year the Black feminists of the Combahee River Collective came together in Dorchester, and before long would literally invent the concept of intersectionality. Let me show you a quick picture of a site in my neighborhood that in some ways pushed me to start thinking about this project. This is literally a few blocks from where I've lived for the past 25 years or so. We're looking at 1 Camp Street in Cambridge, which used to be the home of Rounder Records and the second branch of Fort Apache Studios. There is simply no telling the story of the modern sounds of Boston, Massachusetts without Fort Apache. It anchored an amazing run in the 80s and 90s that included the Lemonheads, the Pixies, Blake Babies, Belly, Throwing Muses, Volcano Suns, Big Dipper, the Breeders, Mighty Mighty Boss Tones, not to mention Radiohead, David Bowie, and Hole as well. The original Fort Apache was in Roxbury and was named explicitly to make a claim about white people operating in hostile territory. I'm not looking for bad guys in the music scene. Here you see a picture of the two guys on the far right are two of the founders of Fort Apache. But I am deeply interested in how the structural racism that shaped Boston's public schools, its patterns of residential segregation, and so on, also very much shape the contours of the music scenes I'm aiming to chronicle. So there's no doubt that the founders of Port Apache meant something when they decided to name their studio. I won't get into the very complicated racial and ethnic politics of the 1948 John Ford movie, Fort Apache, or the quite a bit simpler and more horrifying racial politics of the 1981 Paul Newman movie. But the men who founded the studio in 1986, including the working class East Boston native who was given the name Joseph Incagnoli at birth, but was much better known as Joe Harvard as a joke about the college he attended, definitely thought of their original Roxbury site as what producer and later co-owner Gary Smith described to me as, quote, the last outpost of white safety. Here's the original building of the first Fort Apache in Roxbury. As I begin to draw the maps of Boston that define the various music scenes of the post-1974 era, it has become clear to me that for many white musicians, Boston mostly meant a few neighborhoods. Kenmore Square, Alston Brighton, Fenway, sometimes Mission Hill, sometimes Jamaica Plain. More than a few white people I've interviewed already have said about Roxbury, you just didn't go there. Of all the white music business people I've spoken to so far, I don't think one has been able to tell me any other place they ever went to in Roxbury besides Fort Apache. The founders of Fort Apache and some musicians associated with it have wanted to establish that Roxbury really was dangerous. The lore about Roxbury usually boils down vaguely to, quote, it was the years of the crack epidemic, and more particularly, the gear got stolen from the van, a real concern for struggling musicians. I'm showing you the map again, just so you can see, if you're not familiar with Boston, how close Roxbury is to the top third of the map, which is where most of the white Indian punk and rock and roll music was being made. I can't give any kind of history of Roxbury's racial dynamics today, but let me note that the neighborhood had undergone dramatic white and especially Jewish flight beginning in the 1950s and was the object of both malign attack and benign neglect from business interests, banks, and city government for decades. In fact, the same year that Fort Apache was founded as a, quote, outpost of white safety in Roxbury, a group of activists brought a non-binding ballot question to Boston voters that would have led to the secession of Roxbury from the city to be renamed Mandela. The real point here, of course, is that the dominant white culture of Boston had seceded from Roxbury a long time earlier. Now, of course, Roxbury was certainly very much on the musical map by the time of Fort Apache's founding. New Edition's smash hit Candy Girl topped the Billboard charts in 1983. And as the great Boston journalist and historian Dart Adams has recently pointed out, the group shouted out Roxbury frequently. But that group came up with a series of local talent shows organized Maurice Starr that occupied a completely different map of Boston than that that was occupied by the white musicians and producers who founded Fort Apache. So aside from this one crucial outpost in Roxbury, it's clear that the white Indian punk rock scene was centered in a very small part of Boston, Alston Brighton and Kenmore Square above all. And it probably goes without saying that the anchor institution of that part of Boston's cultural geography was the Rat. The bands that dominate mythologies surrounding the Rat were mostly bands that never really broke outside of Boston in a sustained way. Bands that had incredibly devoted local followings and not so much in the way of discography. Crucial to the mythology of the Rat is that everybody was welcome there. This is the central premise of Andy Sava Kovat's documentary on the club, and it is a formidable rhetorical formation in all oral histories, including the interviews I've begun to do. But whenever I've screened that documentary for my Social History of Popular Music class at UMass Boston over the past decade or so, with all of its amazing stage and crowd footage, this is the Groupie Gals here, almost invariably one student at this majority minority school will ask, so were Black people allowed in that club? And the very helpful answer I give is usually something along the lines of, it depends what you mean by allowed. Black and interracial acts appeared on stage, of course, but nobody can remember many Black people in the audience, or Latinx or Asian people for that matter. I have a colleague at UMB who remembers going to the Rat often with her brother in the 1980s and noticing that they were usually the only Asians in the crowd. In fact, the everybody welcome vibe seems to apply much more accurately to Narcissus, a club just across Kenmore Square from the Rat, which was, as Maura Johnston has explained, a crucial site for the circulation of the electropop subgenre known as freestyle, but also hosted disco, funk, and heavy metal shows. Narcissus does not get nearly the attention that the Rat does, and this imbalance in the historical record alone has some tales to tell. But Narcissus and the Rat, had at least one thing in common. Both ultimately were destroyed by the voracious appetite of Boston University, which destroyed the buildings that each was housed in. Here's the rat in rubble. It was utterly predictable that BU would destroy these clubs to make way for more upscale tenants. In the case of the rat, the luxury hotel Commonwealth, and this was all part of BU's ongoing effort to turn Boston into what DeVarian Baldwin has in his recent book called a campus city. Here's a suite in the Hotel Commonwealth that is a rat-themed rock and roll suite. So that's what's left of the rat in this little bit of imperialist nostalgia. I think it is not overreaching to say that the person of color most famously and regularly associated with the rat is a character generally known as Mr. Butch, pictured here, a street person whose given name was Harold Madison Jr. Mr. Butch was often found outside the club, sometimes singing, orating, and or playing auto harp until BU police pushed him to the streets of Allston. James Ryan, who ran the Hoodoo Barbecue upstairs from the rat, speaks eloquently in a short film made by S.G. Collins in 2001 called Searching for Mr. Butch, about the central role the African-American man played in the larger scene. After years hanging around the rat, the BU private police force rousted him. In Collins's documentary, both Mr. Butch and Ryan are clear on this point. I can't begin to discuss all the complexities of Mr. Butch's place in the Boston scene. All I want to point out now is how powerful the forces of segregation were in Boston in this era, the 1970s, 1980s, into the 90s. Structured by school and residential segregation, by more than 50 years of culture industry investment in the idea of distinct white and black cultures and so on, it remains striking to me that when I ask scene denizens to try to remember who they encountered socially in these spaces who was black, more than a few seem to first draw a blank and then ultimately say something like, well, there was Mr. Butch, of course. Now, of course, there were plenty of white people in this era of Boston's history who interacted with a range of black people on a regular basis. I want to focus on one figure to try to invoke something about the complexity of interracial intimacy in Boston in this era. That figure is now known as Mark Wahlberg. I'm interested in this talk today only in the Marky Mark years. Because I assume you all know at least a little bit about Marky Mark, I'll jump right in. There are a few dates to keep in mind. First, 1984, then the linked dates of 1986 and 1988, and finally 1991. In a second, I'm going to show you young Mark Wahlberg dancing with his Dorchester-based crew, the Electric Generation, at a Rock Against Racism event, Rock Against Racism sponsored event held at Jamaica Pond in 1984. Rock Against Racism, a Boston activist and education group, counted YASPM and UMass Boston's own Rebe Garofalo as a key organizer. Mark Wahlberg's childhood and young adulthood were situated along some very explosive interracial and interethnic fault lines that triangulated white, black, and the rising Vietnamese migrant population. The crew you'll see Wahlberg dancing with here was interracial and international, white, black, Guatemalan, Puerto Rican, Dominican, with members living in Dorchester, South Boston, Roxbury, and Jamaica Plain. Their mission statement was organized around their intention to make all viewers feel that, quote, you are welcome in each and every one of their neighborhoods. So let me just show you a quick second of this.
107 Hill, South Boston, Roxbury, JP.
That's Marky Mark in the gray pants. Now I want to move to 1986 and 1988. If this Rock Against Racism performance is a bracing shot of progressive Boston interracialism, the chaser is bitter indeed, as I'm sure many of you know. In 1986, 15-year-old Wahlberg engaged in two attacks on young African-Americans, one that involved throwing wretched racial slurs and one of which involved throwing rocks at a bus full of school children on a field trip to Savin Hill Beach in Dorchester. This was, of course, eerily reminiscent of the anti-desegregation riots of a decade earlier. 2 years later, in April of 1988, Wahlberg was involved in brutal attacks on two different Vietnamese men, Tan Lam and Johnny Hoa Trinh, in Dorchester in April of 1988. Now I'll turn to 1991. Although Wahlberg did not apply for a pardon for his hate crimes until much later, I want to suggest that by the late 1980s and early 1990s, Wahlberg was already developing a process of cultural rinsing. In short, it seems clear that Wahlberg, in his rap persona as Marky Mark, operationalized his social adjacency to hip hop which of course grew out of his actual proximity to Black people in Dorchester and other parts of Boston, as a powerful vehicle of racial redemption. At the same time, I think his work at least tacitly participated in the erasure of the burgeoning Asian American population in his own neighborhood. Wahlberg's horrific attacks took place in the broader context of a spike in anti-Asian violence in the mid to late 1980s, and which definitely reads as part of the fallout of the school desegregation crisis of the 1970s. This all comes clear in an amazing report that a group of Asian American scholars and activists published on the troubling rise in anti-Asian hate crimes in Boston that they released in 1987 called To Live in Peace, Responding to Anti-Asian Violence in Boston. The clip I'm going to show you in a minute is from the song Wild Side, originally written by the African-American rapper MC Spice, built around a sample from Lou Reed's 1972 song Walk on the Wild Side, though I'd venture that Wahlberg's access to the track may have come through Tribe Called Quest's 1990 song Can I Kick It, which is also based, which is also built on its baseline. I'm sure most of you know both songs, so I'll just note that Reed's is notorious for its narration of Demi Moore's sexual activity and its ironic, provocative introduction of its background vocalists. Tribe Called Quest only used the rhythm track and certainly did not quote Reed's ambivalently ironic line about the backup singers. But Wahlberg is nothing if not unironic. In the music video, the white rapper, as you'll see, is surrounded by young African-American men, a number of whom are wearing the then fashionable Malcolm X baseball caps. And the video features Black women, mourners attending funerals, presumably of the victims of gun violence, lip-syncing the doot-doot-doos of Reed's chorus. The song is, I guess, socially conscious in a superficial sort of way. Wildside narrates gritty urban crime tales and is centered on a retelling in particular of two notorious Boston murder cases, the 1988 murder of 12-year-old Tiffany Moore in Roxbury and the 1989 murder of Carol Stewart on Mission Hill by her husband. Tiffany Moore was killed in a drive-by shooting while sitting on a mailbox, and the pregnant Carol Stewart was murdered by her husband, who blamed the crime on an unknown Black assailant, thereby setting off a police reign of terror against Black men. In the song, Marky Mark reminds his listeners about the racial profiling and police violence that ensued in the wake of Charles Stewart's 1989 murder of his wife. Wildside, as you'll see, is defined by its lyrical and visual engagement with African-American people, imagery, and political concerns. So let me cue up just under a minute of it so you can see a little bit of what I'm talking about.
One for life. Ron became another victim of homicide because he chose to walk on the wild side. Had everything going for him. A top-paying job, a good life, a good wife, a baby boy on the way any day. A gentleman attitude is all he displayed. Cal was the wife he loved and adored. Her family and friends treated him like an ambassador. One night on the other side of town, a police dispatcher picked up a weird sound. Charles on the car phone asking for help, claiming a burglar shot his wife and himself. His pregnant wife lay slumped over, her dreams corrupted, a young life over. Extensive searches throughout the projects put a lot of people through misery and wreck.
There are, I should don't know, Asian Americans featured on the record or in the videos. While the number of Asians and Asian Americans in the Boston area steadily increased in this era, they remain largely absent from the cultural landscape of music, film, and televisual representation, which developed here. But they were quite present, of course, in a swath of demonizing and marginalizing Hollywood films, most notably Rambo. The authors of To Live in Peace made a strong case that these anti-Asian representations energized dangerous street-level violence here in Boston. Now, Mark Wahlberg, Marky Mark's entry into the hip-hop world came through connections forged by his brother, New Kids on the Block's Donnie Wahlberg, who had been discovered and promoted like New Edition by Black Boston impresario Maurice Starr. Mark Wahlberg was at least briefly a New Kid himself. In Wildside, I want to argue Marky Mark's Funky Bunch, the X-Caps, the Black Women Mourners are all meant to convey his new identity as a sort of Boston white anti-racist everyman. In 3 short years, Wahlberg had operationalized and monetized his access to Black people and Black culture in Boston to stake a claim as a quasi-insider. I'll also note that commercially speaking, his record far eclipsed the other major Boston rap release of that year from Edo G and the Bulldogs, which also had a very detailed rap on it about the Charles Stewart case. This example of Marky Mark reminds us, as so many Black scholars have, that integration often comes with some real and profound losses for African Americans. But the segregated world of white rock music in Boston hardly represents any socially progressive or economically equitable model. So there we are. The dynamic intertwining of local political and economic realities and emerging cultural rhetorics and formations is the crossroad at which I'm trying to plot so much of this work in the modern sounds of Boston, Massachusetts. Thanks so much for listening, and I really look forward to hearing your comments and questions. The title of my talk today is...
Only once, Jeff. Okay. All right. Only get one turn. All right. Thanks.
Excellent.
Glad we both made it work. So,
excellent.
So, Lucretia, since you showed your presentation first, can I ask you the first question?
Okay.
All right. Are you ready? I know I'm bringing you back on screen and saying get right to it. But I was you sort of hinted at a few answers to this, and so I want to just try to sort of bring the camera in a little bit. Okay. Towards the end of your talk, you spoke wonderfully about all the different ways groupies sort of spoke through music, spoke through the way they carried themselves in the world, spoke through their sexuality. So the one area I didn't really hear you talk much about, but I saw some glimpses of, had to do with fashion. And there were a couple pictures, particularly in the early 1970s, the slide right before the GTO slide and then the GTO slide, where I just started thinking about like, how were these, like, what was the retail culture? What was the artistic culture of fashion? Just like, how were women who got called groupies using their dress as one more way of, one more communicative act? Does that make sense?
Totally. And I love that question. And I just made a note to myself to make sure that I discuss that in this book if I really get a book deal and get to write this. Because I think fashion was crucial, especially like the GTOs, because at least from what I've gathered in my research, is they didn't have a lot of money and clothes, vintage clothes were cheap then. And it was before it was called vintage, before it was cool. And so it was a way of dressing up from the past, but making it new for themselves. And I also think, like each of the women that I discussed so far today, each of them specifically has their own style, and each of them actually, it reflects their musical allegiance, I think. I love that question. Also, just real quick, you know, Betty Davis introduced her husband, Miles Davis, to Jimi Hendrix, or Jimmy to Miles, and it affected how Miles dressed, and it affected his music. So they're actually so interwoven, the music and the fashion. I don't know if that answered your question, but.
That's great. No, and I was thinking of people who were like literally sort of crossover people in that world. And I'm blanking on her full name, but there was that woman, Sue, spelled S-Z-O-U, who
Susie
was, who had the thrift store that was like so crucial. I just remember sort of vaguely touching on that in my Manson research, but it seems like the fashion just seems like an important nexus for a lot of what you're getting at. It's so fascinating.
It yeah. is.
Thanks.
So I actually have a question. I don't know, is it okay if I ask a question of Jeff? So Jeff, I didn't read any of the chat questions yet. So maybe this was already asked by somebody, but, and maybe it's not, I don't know. What is it? I know you live in Boston. So how has it affected you? Like, what is it that draws you to this? Has it affected you in your own life?
That's a great question. I've lived here for, in exile, you know, for about 30 years now. I moved here in the late 80s. And it's been Cambridge all along. I just want to be clear about that. People in Boston would be really upset if I claimed any kind of Boston denizen status. Cambridge is quite distinct. But I really, you know, it's funny, like I've been very much sort of like adjacent to this world. I had friends who were involved in the scene in the late 80s when I first came here for grad school. And I was kind of, you know, anti-scene, and I was in grad school. And in retrospect, I started thinking about all the music that came out of here that I was listening to, from New Edition to the hip hop Edo G, beginning in the late 80s, early 90s, and then later in the 90s, a real, you know, obviously, Gangstar and then Acrobatic and Mr. Lift really putting Boston on the map. I just started thinking, like, how is there not a good cultural history of this, you know, of the music scene in this town? There's a great journalistic history. You know, Brett Milano has written a great book. There are little pieces here and there. And it's like, you know, we're the center of the so-called knowledge economy. That's what I've been involved with. And it just seems like it's like a bizarre gap. And, you know, that's, so it's, I don't know, it seems like an easy project in that way. Like I've been here, I've been teaching this class for 10 years at UMass Boston. In doing so, I've been able to make contact with a lot of musicians and club owners, journalists in the area who have come and talked to the class. It's a really, I guess my shorter answer is it's a really small town. And it took me a while to sort of embrace that and realize that, and that you can pretty much get anybody on the, you know, on the phone or on a Zoom call if you're situated like I am in, you know, in a university. And it's really interesting to like relearn the map of Boston that I've been kind of living on, you know, for 30 years, but not really paying enough attention to all the pieces. So yeah, thanks. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, the other thing is I know we don't, I don't think we have someone who's gonna check the chat screen, or maybe someone will, but I'm gonna check it and see if there are some questions. But I just have this other thing that I wanted to mention that I was thinking about with Marky Mark. I mean, I don't wanna do any like character defamation. So I'm not gonna say some of the things I'm thinking, but I will say this. I love what you said about how, what he does is he draws from the culture around him. And the music is influencing him, as is the style, the mannerisms, and the dance moves. So I love that you mentioned that, and how you mention that at the same time though, or like recently, he does some things that are actually racist and violent. So I really think about that, like how, I know we all influence each other, but I just wonder about his, what do you think about that, I guess, as I'm trying to say it without really saying what I want to ask?
No, it's a great question. I want to spend more time with it, and I'll turn to the audience in a second, because I see hands going up, but I'm really interested in this question of why, like the question of age, how people age into racism. You know, this is like a really standard, you know, well-known narrative in American, race history, is that, you know, on plantations and, you know, in slavery era South, you know, white kids and black kids would play together until black children were expected to go to work, you know, to go to work at age, say, 5, right? And so there's that question of sort of like how racism is kind of age dependent, you know? And so Marky Mark is this great object of the Rock Against Racism program. You know, he's a young teenager, he just wants to dance. Again, I want to say the name of my great colleague and friend, Rebe Garofalo, who was such a crucial part of that effort in Boston. They did amazing work. Some of it really carried over, and people became lifelong activists who were involved with that program. But some, like Marky Mark, like aged into the kind of most available racist structures that kind of shaped their schools, their neighborhoods, their, yeah. So I definitely want to think more about that. It's a great question.
That's very interesting.
Okay. So I'm going to jump in, and we can start, we can just sort of open it up to the larger group and begin the Q&A. The audience. All right, so Anne has a question. Anne, I don't know if you want to unmute.
I'm cooking as usual. Here I am in the kitchen. That was great. I really, both of these projects are, revisioning kind of truisms in our understanding of different moments in rock history, and I really appreciate that. I love Jeff, what you're doing, as I said in the chat, is such an important thing for all of us who came up in punk and indie to confront our own nostalgia and to think more holistically about what happened in those scenes and who was excluded from scenes that were, that thought of themselves as like inclusive to all marginalized people, them mostly being marginalized white kids, white middle-class kids like myself. Anyway, but my question is for you, Lucretia. I love what you're doing. I'm so excited to have a potential book combining all of these stories and this whole history. There's been a lot of sort of, you know, one era here, one person's story there and stuff, but I love this idea of a kind of universal study of groupies and telling these stories. But two questions. One is, how do you mark the beginning of the groupie era? Because certainly there were women companions whether it be for a night or for a season or for a lifetime for rock stars, as long as they were rock stars or any musicians. And then, you know, I kind of feel like at a certain point, the identity of the groupie shifts, like the women aren't claiming that identity as much, maybe. So how do you market by self, like the moment when women start identifying themselves as groupies, or do you market as, you know, when the Rolling Stone groupie issue happens? So that's my one question. And then related, I guess, is how is the fact of Me Too and the kinds of confrontations with another form of nostalgia, you know, about women's relationships to rock stars and their empowerment or disempowerment, how is that affecting your view of this subject?
Okay. Well, with the first question, I was wondering that same thing. How do I start this? When do I think groupiedom started? Like, when did it start? So I just thought, you know what? I'm going to go to Lillian Roxon's Rock Encyclopedia. I'm going to see if she lists the word groupie and see what she says. And so she said she starts it. She herself starts it. She defines groupie. And then she says it began in 65 to 66. So I thought, you know what? I'll start it then. And so with Me Too, so interesting about that, because my boss, my supervisor at my last job, he knew of my obsession with groupies, and he said, well, how are you going to deal with Me Too with this? So he got me thinking about it, and which I find interesting because he's male and he was my boss in this hierarchy of capitalism. So I thought that was interesting. So that relates to your question. And so I did start wondering about how careful I want to be when I tell the story of groupies who are underage, because some of the women I've interviewed who were in relationships, whether they were long-term or short-term or solely sexual or also emotional and sexual, were underage. And they do not, the ones I've interviewed, do not feel bad about it. And the ones I've interviewed say they were willing participants. So I want to be very careful about how I present that, because I want to respect their points of view. But it is also true that if Iggy Pop is, who's like, everyone like just bows down to Iggy, and I love Iggy's music. I totally love Iggy's music. But I often think about how like he's got a song called, I think it's Look Away, where he's talking about having sex with an 11-year-old. And, you know, he's over 18 when that song is out. And I think about, and like, he's gotten away with it, and it's in a song, and the song is great. I love that song, but it's something to really think about, like how our culture is so, just allows that. And it's related to sex trafficking, which I actually want to mention in this book. So, and it is so serious. I mean, it's, and I don't want to take too long answering this question. In fact, I'll just stop there. I hope that I answered the question.
No, yeah. I mean, I just want to add that I think the story of Lori Maddox is a kind of a quintessential case study of this. Someone who, you know, had a relationship with Jimmy Page when she was 14, holds, you know, maintains that it was completely consensual, you know, but yet is also by others considered sort of the ultimate victim, as someone who like was locked up in a hotel room when he would go out and party. And so, yeah, I look forward to your wrestling with these issues.
Thanks, Anne.
Okay, thank you. Gus, do you want to unmute and ask your question?
Yeah, thanks. And thanks so much for the talk. And I really look forward to reading this. I think I would. It's a book I would love to read and teach. And so this is somewhat related to Anne's questions, but I was wondering if you ever encountered any discussion of you know, self-identifying groupies talking about themselves as queer or any kind of like sort of descriptor in that realm of things, like maybe, you know, pansexual or even, I guess, even bisexual or, you know, and in a way that might have to do with the gender people they were having sexual relations with in all of this, but also just with a sense that they're challenging something about sexual normativity. And I was wondering also if, like, you know, maybe some would do that retrospectively or something too, even if they didn't do it at the time.
Okay, so being gay and like, or queer, or sleeping with someone who's your gender, in this golden era, it wasn't so golden because that was criminalized then. And I have noticed with the people I've interviewed that they don't want to say that they slept with somebody else in, like, someone, their friend, their same-sex friend. And they don't really want to talk about if they had three ways, you know, or group sex or orgies. It's like, come on, that's one of the things that's so great, tell me. But I think that there's like an internalization of that era's restrictions, which Jeff and I were actually talking about yesterday about being policed, the body being policed. I think, you know, I think the discomfort with talking about the sexual experimentation that is not heterosexual with just one person, I think it's indicative of the internalization of that like police state of sexuality back then. So that wasn't so golden. However, I've got some pretty strong evidence that it happened. And that was part of the connection and the closeness. And it was part of the experimentation then. You know, it was part of, in fact, I have this, I want to jump up and get this magazine, but I'll be leaving a blank space. But I have this Cosmopolitan that I got off eBay. And one of the women in there, I finally got to read the actual thing. And it's Jenny Dean. And I want to talk about her in this book because, oh, what she says in this Cosmo article is so great because you can feel that she's really believing we are changing the world. We get to have sex with whomever. We don't have to be married. We can be friends. And it's like, cool. Like she says that, like that was the actual feeling. But I think I think over time, that contradiction of here we are experimenting in the 60s, but yet it's illegal to actually have sex with each other. I think over time, that experimentation is still being policed. Like we're not allowed to have sex with the same people or with more than one person at a time. Anyway, I don't know if that answered your question, but that is something I want to put in the book because that's a huge, it's part of it. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Evelyn McDonald has a question. Do you want to unmute, Evelyn?
Yes, I'll even turn my video on there. Hello.
Hi.
There I am. this actually follows from that pretty well. Do you talk at all about male groupies, or are you thinking about talking about male groupies, both male groupies of, you know, possibly of male rock stars, but then also of female rock stars. And then I'm also just interested in the way that our representation of the super fan has sort of changed over the decades from the groupie being, you know, the term for a super fan to now it's stan, like it's in a way switched gender. And what does that mean?
That's so interesting too, because Jeff and I were also talking about that, because Jeff and I yesterday were telling each other how there's, you know, the phrases, Jeff was pointing out that there was fangirl and fanboy and how is that different from groupie? And I do talk about some, I will talk about some men, but it does seem that it's like an area where I don't think very many men identify as groupies. It's so female. You know, that'd be kind of cool to have like a bit of writing about that, like how the term groupie is so female. But there is a male groupie who is in this documentary called The Groupies. There is one there. And then there was another person I know who is okay with identifying as a groupie. But so far, I've only got two. But the other thing, well, I'll save that for later. Okay. Thanks, Evelyn.
Thank you for your presentation. I might know someone who would talk to you, a guy who would talk to you that from the 70s in LA. So we'll talk.
I'm texting you later.
Okay, and so I'm gonna go ahead and we have a hand raised here and then I'll go back to the chat again. Tyler, and forgive me if I mispronounce your name, is it Sonishin?
Tyler Sonicson, thank you. Well, first of all, I loved both of the talks today. This is, I absolutely enjoyed them both and learned so much. I have notepads full of notes that I took from both of them. My my question was for Jeff, because Jeff, you and I have been interacting on Twitter a bit recently. And so I became interested. So I think I followed you originally because maybe some music related tweets that came to my timeline about Boston. I was actually born in Boston and I spent the early part of my life there. And this was in the 1980s. And I know you were focusing on the mid 1970s, but in the 80s, I remember there are a few things that still really jump out to me about Boston. That I always associate with that era of my early youth. There was, of course, the Big Dig, which I guess my question is, will that form a big portion of your book? And do you think it's something of a continuation of that segregation and gentrification and redevelopment of the city? And also, was there a tension between, because you mentioned the predominantly white indie bands that were mostly college students, was there a tension between townies and college kids? Because there definitely was, in my research about DC, there was absolutely a tension between the district kids and the Northern Virginia kids, for example. So I was curious about that. Apologies for the kind of two-pronged question, but feel free to address however much of it you'd like.
Fantastic. Good to meet you on screen, at least, Tyler. I'll start with the second part just because it's easier in some way. Absolutely, there's a distinction. You know, one of the weird things is that the people who end up seeming like the most Boston core real rock and roll people, rat associated, are mostly not from Boston. They're mostly like what in my New Jersey history we would have called, you know, bridge and tunnel people. They were, you know, folks from the suburbs, Jonathan Richmond included, but then the, you know, guy Dave Minahan is probably my classic example from the neighborhoods, who's this real suburban kid who just like really takes on this kind of leather jacketed, you know, rat, you know, core guy. It's one of the things I didn't know at the start of the project, because I've been here forever and it was all just, you know, sort of indie punk music to me, is that the sort of college music crowd is completely, or not completely, but relatively distinct from the kind of core garage rock, psych rock, you know, rat, underground, rock and roll club stuff. And before that, there's a whole art movement associated crowd, like the human sexual response guys associated with mass art. And with the museum school, that's really queer, really, really avant-garde, has nothing to do with these other scenes, really, like they all kind of know each other. But like when you talk to, like I talked to, you know, Jonathan Paley from the Nervous Eaters on one end, and then like Damon Krakowski, and then later Claudia Gonson on the far end, like they live in two different worlds, babe. You know, like it's like, you know, that old country song. It's like they sometimes cross paths. They end up sort of coming together in Cambridge in the late 80s and early 90s, really through the work of Billy Ruane, who's a really key figure, kind of music scene entrepreneur, but they really do occupy different landscapes. And then, you know, and then just to throw a fourth term into it, there's the hardcore kids who are really distinct. They're underage, they're playing weird places, you know, they're really, a lot of them involved with anti-racist stuff. So I'm just learning now that like what I thought was just like music, indie music scene, punk scene, it really has a bunch of distinct branches. The Big Dig and zoning and the Bieber bank program of the 1970s. This is all my new, you know, post whatever education and cultural geography. And it's all in there. Big Dig obviously is a crucial part of that. The destruction of the West End to build Government Center, the later destruction of parts of the South End. This is all like in the mix, you know, black and brown people are constantly being moved, constantly being pressured. Chinese people are being pushed out of Chinatown in this era so that it becomes, you know, after huge growth for decades up until, you know, the mid 80s, they keep getting pushed out by various gentrification moves. I think my focus, to be honest, will mostly be on the university piece because it just kind of keeps the youth culture centered, and especially because there's this great literature growing. I mentioned DeVarian Baldwin, but that's just one of many amazing books about the relationship of cities and universities. And Boston just seems like a really, DeVarian Baldwin doesn't write about Boston in his book. You know, his test cases are Hartford and New York and Phoenix. and a couple others. So I feel like Boston, we really have to, there's this like yearly gentrification that happens, you know, 150,000 new people come in every year in September, and it really, it just changes the town. So absolutely. But thank you for the reminder about the big day, because I hadn't really thought much about that.
Okay, Carl, do you want to unmute and ask your question?
Yeah, sure. This question actually comes really directly out of that last one. So I was thinking about, you know, when you were talking about rap and even Marky Mark, we're seeing artists directly addressing local issues. And aside from in hardcore, which I'm sure as it did everywhere, did talk about politics and local politics, I don't associate the rock scene in Boston with being a politicized one that really spoke that language. And I'm curious whether you've found cases of that among those bands for the Rat and that kind of thing that we might not have immediately think about.
Yeah, I mean, you know, again, just back to my little kind of, you know, sad first attempt at a taxonomy. You get it in the late 70s, early 80s with some of the artier, queerer bands, more talking about national political issues, but definitely like human sexual response is pushing all kinds of boundaries in terms of, you know, what you're even allowed to say in popular music, what you're allowed to do on stage. So there's a little bit of that there. And I'm also really interested in this figure, David Greenberger, who's this great, I don't know if you know him. He's this great, this great visual artist. His first thing is he's involved with a band that does a whole cover version of a Captain Beefheart record. Like they're really like pushing it late 70s in a way we don't usually associate with Boston, which tends to seem like a really kind of conservative musical town, but you're absolutely right. It's in the hardcore scene. And it's really, that's the one place where it is. Some of the people, like the person, and again, this is thanks to Holly, who I was able to get in touch with, like Seth Tibben, you know, ended up being really a very political songwriter, but not in these years. It was like sort of when he left Boston, and in some ways he got like, you know, I guess he moved from Boston to Austin. He got like a bigger picture, you know, somehow. But Boston's a really parochial town. Like it really is very like, and I mean parochial in some really delicious, wonderful ways. You know, there's just like a real, like we're here together, we're making great music, and it can stay right there. So I think your question is a good one. And the short answer is probably like, no, haven't done a lot yet.
Richard Cobain, do you want to unmute?
Yeah, there we go. First, I want to say hi to Lucretia because we were on the same panel at PopCon in 2018 when you did your paper on GTOs. So I got a little preview of what you were talking about here today. That was nice.
Hi.
Yeah, Jeff, I was thinking about two different entertainment sectors in Boston, sports and music. And, you know, there's this gigantic history of antagonism, to put it in a nice way, between the crowds at and fans of Boston sports and the players and who is providing the entertainment for them. And, you know, Boston Red Sox being the last team in Major League Baseball to have a Black player, to currently even Danny Ainge saying some things. So it goes for 50 years, really. And I was wondering if there was a similar antagonism scene between crowds and performers, or if that's anything you've even looked into.
Great, thanks. I'll just try to answer quickly because it's one of those like major subjects for further research. But I will say the person I've interviewed most recently for the book is Josh Cantor, whose current job is as organist for the Red Sox. And he, if you haven't heard, I'm not a baseball guy, but he smuggles in all kinds of amazing rock and roll, punk, soul music into his repertoire. But Josh has also played with a bunch of bands in Boston, has a really good eye on the sort of just cultural politics of race in Boston. And one of the things he reminded me of is that like in this era that I'm interested in, and please sports people, if you know stuff I need to know, tell me if I get this wrong, but this in the 80s, the Celtics are this kind of incredibly dominant team and probably the whitest team in the league, and you know, in a sport that's becoming increasingly Black. So I'm just trying to think about like where people, so your question for me, like the thing that's really thrilling about it is just trying to figure out where people are on different days and in different moments in Boston. You know, Fenway Park, I don't know if some of you have been there, I'm sure you have. in, you know, right at the end of my period becomes a place that sometimes, for some really obvious reasons, really welcoming to Dominican people who don't otherwise come there, right? Because there start being some really key Dominican players. And so Josh describes how most days of Fenway, he wouldn't particularly see Dominican flags in the stands, but then on the days that, I'm sorry, I'm blanking on the name of the really famous Dominican pitcher for the Red Sox, somebody save me. Nobody can save me. Really, when I'm a sports player. Okay, doesn't matter. Pedro, thank you, Pedro Martinez. Days he would pitch, the stands would be full of Dominican flags. And then maybe 8 or 10 years later, when Japanese players start coming in, there'd be sort of influx of Japanese people. So I'm really interested in thinking about like the map as it is in the most static way, where people live, where they go to school, those things don't change on a daily basis. But then what are the sites where people do meet each other? And I think sports arenas are kind of interesting places. You know, we always, you know, when I was in grad school, we always used to joke is that if you wanted to be in a gathering, you know, of all white people, just go to a reggae show at the Middle East in Cambridge, right? Because like the fandom was that segregated, right? And if you wanted to see a more mixed crowd, you'd go to the Western Front, which was a little bit off of Central Square and a more kind of black centric place. So I'm really interested in this in the sports world. I really got to get up to speed on it. So thanks for the additional push.
Okay, great. And our final question for tonight, Holly Cruz, do you want to unmute and ask your question?
I'm feeding the dogs, but yes, let me, sure. I just let them in from outside. Well, yes, I just, you know, hearing the talk about Boston, and of course I have come from like this indie music scene from a long time ago, my dissertation and book, perspective, and you know, thinking very narrowly about those music scenes, but putting that out there and specifically indie power pop primarily. But it did get me thinking, just because I've been doing a lot of scanning of radio stations while driving, and like keep hearing songs by Boston, the band that I'd totally forgotten about, and you know, and had maybe been happier because of it. And like they're so generic, and I know they were arena rock from my childhood that I really didn't care for, and I really couldn't distinguish a Boston song from, I don't know, a Foreigner song maybe. I mean, back then when I was, you know, young. And just all these other acts. So it seemed ironic somehow that the band Boston, which sounds like it could have come from anywhere, identified as Boston. And since your history covers, you know, the 70s. And so then I thought, oh, Aerosmith too, I guess. So they, you know, they seem to have to me more of a clear kind of identity in a white working class sort of way. I couldn't have recognized anyone from Boston ever in my life, band, not the city. So yeah, I'm just wondering, did you come across them in your research? I mean, you must have. And yep. What is the relationship of them to the place, to the history, the received history, to the dynamics that you talk about? Where do they come from? I mean, it's kind of like, and then I'll be quiet. You know, one of the scenes I studied because I lived there for graduate school was the Champion Urbana power pop scene, which was actually kind of a big deal. And of course also REO Speedwagon had come from Champaign-Urbana, Illinois, and they were just kind of like a joke or something among the musicians. Even there were Gary Richrath jokes and things I didn't get, but they didn't seem, REO Speedwagon did not seem sort of integral to the institutions, even to the histories. So that is my long-winded kind of meandering statement and question.
That was, That was great. I was on the whole journey with you, Ollie. Thank you. Okay, that was fantastic.
Yeah. I was so halfway to getting the dog bowl when I heard the dishes when I heard my name and scrambled back.
So I'll take it as an opportunity to try to really efficiently say something about Boston and Aerosmith and the cars. So Boston, the piece I want to really get at is the MIT piece and the tech sector piece, right? Like, because that is really interesting in Boston. They hit in exactly this moment when what we're calling Boston, or what we're like sort of bands we're associating with Boston, a lot of them are sort of 128 sector bands, you know, including Jonathan Richman, right, who comes from Natick, which is, you know, half an hour down 128 from Boston. So I want to start thinking about the, you know, Tyler asked a question before about the Big Dig. You know, I want to think about the earlier highway building, really, the kind of 1950s highway building and how that was the kind of pre-story. And then the MIT piece, obviously, is just kind of like what's happening in terms of new technologies that Tom Scholz is bringing into the music, which we hear now is generic, but I think lots of us who are old enough remember as seeming really, really advanced and something new when that first record hit. So I want to think about them in the tech piece. Aerosmith is really interesting to historian. I can't believe I'm about to cite these guys because it's such a weird book in so many ways, but David Foster Wallace and Mark Costello and their book Signifying Rappers, which is such a weird book in so many ways, have a really good piece about Aerosmith and how much their later career absolutely depended on this provisional moment of integration, right? Which is the song, the cover, and really the video of Walk This Way that they did with Run DMC. So I need to sort of figure out how to plot that into this Boston as this kind of like core, you know, white boy rock and roll band in Boston who are really reliant on Black music in a number of ways, including in that very direct way. The Cars are the ones who are totally in the scene, totally wrapped up. They have a studio that's absolutely crucial to a huge number of these bands. They kind of do it on the quiet, like Rick Ocasek isn't like a big sort of grab the stage guy, but the Cars are the ones who I have to sort of figure out how they're kind of like cultural entrepreneurs in the scene or mentors in the scene. So those big bands all matter in different ways to stories, but I'm just kind of like untangling now, which, you know, sort of which rooms to put them in. Great question, thank you.
All right, well, that was a great conversation. Thank you to Lucretia and Jeff. Thank you to all of you for coming.